Om Namah Shivaya. Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya. Om.
Namaste. Well, I'm back up in the mountains, and it's cold. Actually, I have to wear clothes. What a drag. Anyway, we're going to go over the spiritual content in chapters 10, 11, and 12 of the Vidyeshwara Samhita of Shiva Purana. So in chapter 10, the correspondence between the five parts of Aumkara and various other things is given. Remember, in chapter 9, Brahma and Vishnu get initiated into the mantra Aum. This is because, due to the passage of time, they forgot actually about Shiva. So they were competing with one another to be, who would be Lord of the universe. Well, neither of you. So now Shiva says to them, well, the five duties of God are creation, maintenance, destruction, removal, means hiding the remnants of the destroyed universe, and anugraha, or blessing. And that the first four duties in relation to the material universe are delegated to Brahma, Vishnu, Rudra, and Mahesh, respectively. And then the fifth duty, anugraha, blessing, which means giving enlightenment, giving moksha, giving release, can only be done by Shiva himself. So he retains that duty while delegating all the others. But due to the influence of time, Brahma and Vishnu forgot their duties. They forgot that they're acting on behalf of Shiva. How is this possible? Because they're jivas, they're conditioned souls. They become conditioned by the influence of the environment and by time. So over the long span of time between the initial creation and the subsequent creation of the living entities and so on, they forgot. And so Shiva says, now I'm going to initiate you in the mantra Aum, which will stabilize your knowledge, so you won't forget. And interestingly enough, Rudra and Mahesha didn't forget. And the reason for that is that they're jivan muktas. They're liberated. So they didn't forget, even though such a long span of time had elapsed, because they're in constant association with Shiva. And anyone in Shiva's association obviously can never forget his lordship. So anyway, the five parts of the Aumkar are the letters A, U, M, the bindu or dot, and the nada, the curved line underneath the dot. So these five also, by the way, prove that it's not Aum, it's Aum. Three letters, Aum, and the M is held out. That's the meaning of the nada. And then the dot, the bindu, is a half a beat of silence at the end. So in other words, you never say like Aum Namah. No, it's Aum Namah. There's that half beat of silence at the end. Very important, because bindu is Shiva and Shakti combined. It's a dimensionless point of nothingness. It is the void, emptiness. It is the space within which the creation and everything else appears and happens. So this is Aum. Aum is incredibly potent, incredibly powerful means of self-realization, all by itself. And when combined with other parts of the mantra, like Aum Namah Shivaya, then you get the recipe for complete self-realization in one syllable, which is pretty amazing. So moving right along, in chapter 11, the installation and worship of the Shiva Lingam is described. Now, this chapter is so full of information that we could make a whole series on it alone, and in fact, we're going to do that. Up here in the hills, in the village, in the middle of the woods, far away from everything, we're going to build a little temple, and we're going to install a Shiva Lingam. I already got the Shiva Lingam and all the accessories and paraphernalia and supplies for a good long time when I was in Rishikesh, and I brought it back with me. So we're going to actually, instead of just talking about it, we're going to demonstrate it. And you're going to see how everything can be done. Today we surveyed the site for the temple. It's going to be 12 feet square, aligned with the directions, facing east, the door facing east. And inside there's going to be an altar, and it's right next to the spring head. We have a natural spring on the property here. So the water from the spring can come directly into the temple and bathe the Shiva Lingam 24 hours a day. I got the idea from when I was in Rajasthan a long time ago. My God, when was that? 30, 40 years ago. And I was taking a bus somewhere, going somewhere, and I came to this little village called Shivapur. At that time, I knew nothing about Shiva. But someone told me, in this village, there are 108 Shiva temples. And I said, oh, I got to see this. This is amazing. So I got down from the bus, and I went to see the head monk. And he invited me to stay. And he gave me one of the temples and two boys to cook for me and take care and all like that. So I moved into this Shiva temple, and the amazing thing about this temple was it was built on a spring coming right out of the mountain rocks. And this spring was piped directly over the Shiva Lingam and was bathing him. Oh, power cut. Well, we just have to go on anyway, power cut or no power cut. So this Shiva Lingam was getting bathed with pure spring water 24 hours a day. And the prasadam water went into a reflecting pool. And that, in turn, went into one of the irrigation and wash water canals. There's an incredible set of canals built by the Rajput kings 500 years ago, still operational up in Rajasthan. So anyway, I got the idea, wouldn't it be great to have a Shiva temple where Shiva is bathed 24 hours a day? He's very appreciative of this kind of service. He really loves it because it keeps him cool. You know, he's especially in his Rudra form, he's very fiery. So he likes coolness. He likes to be up in the Himalayas where it's cold. So instead of going through all this in chapter 11, I'm going to skip directly to chapter 12 and start talking about the results of worshiping Shiva. So in this chapter, the results of worshiping Shiva are described, and basically they are in line with the effort and resources that one expends in the worship. There are many different suggestions at different levels of effort and expertise in the worship of Shiva. Now, worshiping Shiva is so easy. You can just begin with the five-syllable mantra, Om Namah Shivaya. Very easy. And this mantra is self-initiating, even though if you have a guru, it's, of course, recommended to take the mantra by initiation. But if not, simply start chanting and the mantra itself will initiate you because Shiva is present in the mantra. And if you start this chanting, you'll certainly feel that effect. But that's only the beginning. There's so much more that you can do. And actually, anybody can do. Anybody can offer Shiva water, food, some scented oils or some incense. You know, these are very easy to come by anywhere in the world. If you can, offer bilva leaves. Shiva loves bilva leaves. And I mean, there's so many other things. In chapters 10 and 11, different ways to worship Shiva. And specifically in chapter 12, the sacred rivers and the holy places connected with them are begun to be described. Later on, they're described in so much more detail. This is just really a summary. So if it at all possible, you should come to India and stay in a sacred place dedicated to Shiva, even for one day, or one night. For example, nearby here, there is a place called Jageshwar. Jageshwar is one of the Jyotirlingams. Jyotirlingams mean one of the most powerful self-manifested lingams that there are in the world. There are 11 or 12, depending on who you ask. And they are also described in Shiva Purana later on. But anyway, there are several guest houses in this place, and both in the nearby the temple itself and a little bit farther off, 4 kilometers off, in the village. So you can stay at this place and you can visit the temple and you can hang out with the devotees who are very fired up and doing a lot of ceremonies in and around the temple every day, all day. So it's like a very potent center of spiritual activity, and simply to go there is to be blessed. I'm telling you from experience. What happened was, about a year and a half ago, I had developed sciatica, which, if you don't know, it's a very annoying lower back pain. So this was really inhibiting me, and I was trying all kinds of remedies. Nothing worked. So I was just tolerating as best I could. Finally, I went to Jageshwar. And in Jageshwar, there's a pool in a fresh flowing mountain stream. Very cool. But anyway, it's reputed to have great powers. So I said, oh, what the heck? You know, what's the worst that can happen? I can get pneumonia, right? And so I went in, and you're supposed to dip fully into the stream 3 times and chant Om Namah Shivaya. So I did that. And yes, it was freezing cold. But when I came out, I got dried out, you know, dried off in the sun and like that. And I all of a sudden noticed my back pain is gone. And it stayed gone. And it's still gone. In fact, my back is just getting stronger and stronger. Of course, I do hatha yoga every day, and that's helping the recovery. But the point is, that was a bona fide miracle cure. So everyone should make whatever effort is necessary to visit, we're back, to visit a holy place of Shiva at least once in your life. do yourself a favor, huh? And it's worth the effort, even if you have to travel a long ways, even if there's some danger or uncertainty involved, even if you don't know the local language, it doesn't matter. Somehow get yourself to one of these 12 Jyotirlingas and take bath, associate with the devotees, get darshan of the deity, and do some worship, make some offering, do some service, do something. Because whatever you do, and especially if it's during one of the times, the astrological periods mentioned in this chapter, whatever you do is thousands and millions of times more beneficial than doing the same service anywhere else. So it's really worthwhile. I mean, I've been coming to India since 1971. At first, I was a Vaishnava. Not only did I not know anything about Shiva, I was actually inimical because we had been indoctrinated in a sectarian view that only Vishnu is God, only Krishna is God, and like that. So, in fact, the Vaishnava scriptures even say that one who wears the three-lined pundra goes to hell. That's not very nice, because Shiva is actually Brahman. He's actually the God. And Vishnu is simply his expansion for maintenance of the universe. So anyway, now that I've become actually connected with Shiva, I'm making so much advancement. It's amazing how everything has accelerated. I've been talking about this for the past couple of years, since I became a devotee of Shakti. Because Shakti, of course, is simply the feminine half of Shiva. And so her mood is to make you like Shiva. She likes that, and she actually arranges everything for you so that you can become like Shiva, and she can keep you, adopt you as her son. As her child. So if you graduate from being a Shakta, you become a Shaiva, which is someone who is a devotee of Shiva and who is becoming like Shiva. And that is the purport of all the information given in these three chapters, how to become like Shiva and attain the highest enlightenment. Aum Tat Sat. Aum Shakti Aum. Aum Namah Shivaya.